When talking about alternate shells for Windows, there's simply no way around it. Microsoft Bob, the playful alternate Windows UI that took up front later years ever so annoying Office assistants, maybe even more annoying than Mr. Know-It-All. And before you say something, yes, it also runs on Windows Me. It's obsolete technology no one uses today, but I'll bring it back to life. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. According to Wikipedia, Bob was intended to present a more friendly interface to computer users. But Bob was certainly more than just an interface, as it came with a suite of application software like a word processor, to-do list, and even a financial planner. Taking into account his 1995 Microsoft ad, the application was clearly targeted for family computers and obviously adults. Computer manuals, they're history. Nobody wants to read them, they never make sense. All I want to do when I buy my software is take it home and use it. Well, enter Bob, the newest program from Microsoft Home. It's based on the old KISS principle. Keep it simple, stupid. You have a conversation essentially with this guy, so with Java Dragon or Rover the dog. Start the program, up comes Rover, and Rover says. Yet, it runs not only on Windows 3.1 but also on Windows NT, which feels somewhat out of place. Microsoft presented Bob at the CES in spring 1995, so mere 6 months before the release of Windows 95.
Wait a second, so they released this super fancy new GUI thing just ahead of the revolutionary Windows 95.
For consumer users like us who already use PCs, we will never use it. But for the brand new user who's never had a PC, I don't think it's baby-like. I think it does represent the next generation of interfaces, the social interface, and it does have ramifications of bringing more and more people into it.
Bob has no manual, no menus, no help screens, no text commands. You manage your tasks simply by clicking on icons and moving around different rooms in Bob's house.
Having said that, installing Microsoft Bob waves the typical 90s flair and, for something that is obviously intended to take away the technicality and adding jelly beans, it's still overly abstract and technical. Eventually, you'll end up with this smiley icon. But you can't go into Bob just like that, as it first has to undertake a graphics benchmark to optimize for best results. And then you end up at the front door, which is also featuring the prominent Gateway 2000 logo on the bottom left. That's because I'm using the OEM version here, as Gateway bundled Bob with some of their machines and was thus probably the biggest contributor to the installed base of a whopping 58,000. Yes, 58,000 copies said to be. So obviously, Microsoft Bob was not a critical success. But why was that? One reason could definitely have been the lousy performance. Even though I'm running in an emulation here, I've configured it to be a contemporary 1995 DX2 class machine. I had to configure the emulation to provide at least 8 MB of RAM and a graphics card capable of displaying 256 colors, but still, it would be very choppy and barely usable. Now, I could of course demonstrate this on a real 486, but since I did the Windows 95 install on the 386 recently, I'm cured from any such masochistic hands-on for a while. Let's switch over to Windows Me.
It doesn't run.
Nah, this error doesn't mean anything, as it can just be clicked away and then the setup continues.
Yeah, but look here, there's no point in shoehorning it onto Windows Me.
I've been reading about this one as well. This distortion happens when a color depth higher than 8-bit is chosen. Let's tune it down to 256 colors. See, that looks a lot better now. As a first-time user, you're supposed to register yourself with a username and some additional, optional data. Now, for anyone asking, no, this doesn't register with a Windows user account, especially not on Windows NT. Bob handles this purely internal, even so it is asking you even for a password. And that doesn't seem to be very secure after all, because for one thing, Bob organizes some of its data in Microsoft Access database files. And when opening it up and navigating to the user table, you'll find your unencrypted password. But it doesn't have to be even as complicated as that, as simply entering your password wrongly multiple times will be enough to set a new password, with no further questions being asked by Rover the dog. Once you have taken this hurdle, you'll end up in the first room, which is an alliteration, where things like the calendar, the paper and pencil on the desk, the purse and other objects represent your applications, of which most come bundled with Bob. So let's have a look at Letter Writer. Rover will guide you through the creation process. This may look easy to anyone not familiar with computers, especially back in the days, but it also doesn't give you a lot of freedom, as you just have to step it through. Also, the formatting options are somewhat limited, but it gets the job largely done. Of course, you can always reopen your letter from within Letter Writer, but where would the documents essentially be stored? As Bob predates Windows 95 by several months and was supposed to run on Windows 3.x, it doesn't know anything about recent documents or even the My Documents folder. As you see, it's all empty. So where is the letter? So I looked again into those Access database files, one of which bears the name Utopia. Now, if you're wondering, Utopia was the development name of Microsoft Bob, and that obviously stuck for one of those internal database files. The UPIC database, which is obviously a derivative of Utopia Pictures, seems to hold the clipboard files as so-called binary blob data. Not what I'm looking for, but still a nice insight. Though, looking at the Utopia database, there's also a TOC table, a table of contents. And see, here's two documents I created which point to actual files. Interestingly enough, these are stored within the MSBob program folder. Let's have a look at those files, shall we? So opening one of them up in Notepad, it also reveals it's at least one of the looked for text documents. And obviously, it's a binary format, but the question is, what format is it? It's definitely not a WordPad document, as the format only came with Windows 95, which brought WordPad along. But it's also not a Microsoft Works document, neither for Works 95 nor for Works 3.0. Also, Microsoft Word doesn't know to do anything meaningful with it either, neither as an RTF document, not even a legacy Windows Write document. So this may already be one of the criticism points here, as even when you choose to work with Bob, your documents were actually hard, if not near to impossible to come by, and yet the developers, for whatever reason, didn't even choose to use at least one well-known and compatible data format. This is a pity, especially as they certainly were not shy in using Microsoft Access underneath, so why not use a compatible document format? Now, you may or may not know that Microsoft also created software products for kids, most notably Creative Writer and Fine Artist. As they are similarly playful in style like Bob, one could come to the conclusion Microsoft at least used the document format of Creative Writer for Bob's own letter writer, but certainly not, these are totally incompatible. And speaking about the UI, the kit software feels much more productive than the Bob counterparts, whether that's LetterWriter or any of the other programs, whether that be the checkbook or the financial guide. And with the latter two, one can clearly say the target audience was adults, or wasn't it? Maybe even Microsoft wasn't also sure about this themselves, as this ad here ran on the Cartoon Network, which leaves me with some questions after all. At least, they had an Easter egg revealing all the names of the involved people, including David Thatcher, who presented it at the CES 1995. After all, there was sort of a backup program hidden in Bob's program folder. And maybe it's just me, but I totally didn't find how to run it from within Bob, but you can launch it from Windows directly, although you must not be signed in to perform the backup. This would end up in a newly created backup folder and allow for a potential restore. Still, it's not a real backup onto offhand's media, for that you're still required to use an ordinary backup program. Microsoft did obviously have further plans for Bob. They released Great Greetings, an add-on that only runs in conjunction with Microsoft Bob. At least, this way I can demo how Rover would be used to add a new program, even though with the same boring default installer we all know. I'll then end up with this new card object here, which I can freely move around, so let's put it up on this shelf. After all, Microsoft Bob was obviously a dud. Although it initially received some positive response, it was ultimately not accepted by users and sold only like 58,000 copies until its demise in 1996. Compare that to Windows 95, which reached 45 million copies worldwide after just 3 months. Melinda Gates, who at the time worked on the Bob project, admitted in later years that the resource demand for Bob was simply too high. Well, that's one way of seeing it. But personally, I think, with its exuberant user guidance, it was all in all too restrictive and maybe missed on either target audience, whether that was kids or adults. And yet the choice for incompatible file formats was maybe not the best one either. Microsoft's failure on Bob also seemed to have been a victim of puns and jokes, eventually even culminating into the creation of a satirical reincarnation of Bob going by the name of Bubba, which clearly draws recognition from the original.
Y'all come back now. What you want? What you want? What you want?
Y'all try our cheese wiggles. They ain't good, but they's handy.
Apparently, some relics of Bob have resurfaced over the years, be that Rover the dog, who made a reappearance on Windows XP's file search.
It is said that every copy of Microsoft Windows included a hidden copy of Microsoft Bob, secretly planted there by one of the original Windows developers.
Also, Dave Plummer has an interesting fun story to share, and I recommend you go watching it, as he had added a binary encrypted blob of Microsoft Bob into the Windows XP setup CDs, basically as a means for their copy protection needs. So years after Bob's pivotal fail, it finally shipped into the millions, without people even knowing about it. What do you think about Bob? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was the last story in my series of alternate Windows shells for now. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.